Hi, Tim.
Hi, Liz. How are you doing?
Good, thank you. You're a chief Asia-Pacific equity strategist, and you've recently written a report about how the rise of the digital economy has significantly changed the market composition of Asia's equity markets. Can you give us a sense of your findings?
Asia's market composition has changed significantly in the past decade, and we think this is very much the result of the rise of the so-called digital economy. To quantify this, we've noted that concentration has increased at the market, sector, and the stock level, where, for example, China now accounts for 40% of the regional index, up from 20% 5 years ago. The internet sector now accounts for 22% of the regional index, up from just 5% 5 years ago. And the top five stocks have risen from 19% of the index 5 years ago to 28% currently. So this is a clear manifestation of the higher growth that the digital economy has delivered. And what we note is that the internet sector has grown at a 20% compound annual growth rate over the past decade, whereas every single other sector, with the exception of insurance, has grown less than 5%. So the rise of the digital economy is really fundamentally based and has had very significant transformative effects on the composition of Asia's equity indices.
So what are the intra-regional dynamics of this trend?
Well, there's been some very significant regional shifts, intra-regional shifts, and the key winner of this has been China, which, as I mentioned, has gone from 20% just 5 years ago to a 40% weighting, both organic growth as well as new listings. And the loser of this has been ASEAN, the Association of Southeast Asian Nations, which are comprised of Singapore, Indonesia, Malaysia, Thailand, and the Philippines. Back in the 1990s, ASEAN made up 40% of the regional index. Now it's just 5%. And the average daily trading volume for these five markets is only $5 billion a day, which is less than the top two China stocks. So ASEAN has become much, much less relevant. China has become much, much more important. And one of the key statistics that we've noted is if you look for a proxy for innovation and growth, one way of looking at this would be to estimate or quantify the average age of the listed companies in each index. For most of the markets in Asia, that's between 20 and 25 years. In other words, the same companies have been in the index for two decades or more. In China's case, the average age of listing is just 7. It's by far the youngest listed equity index in the region, which is an indication of the degree of innovation, growth, and new company formation, which is really what's been driving this ascent of the digital economy.
And who are the primary beneficiaries of this new market structure?
Well, one of the takeaways that we've had from this analysis we've done is noting that there are a number of large cap companies which really are turning out to be the winners in their space fundamentally and in terms of equity market performance and in terms of equity market cap. So we've done a screen of some of the best performing companies, the largest ones, the most liquid ones, and the ones with the best fundamental characteristics in terms of returns on equity, profit growth, investment in R&D, pricing power, and so forth. We've dubbed these the digital dozen. They make up in the high 20% of the regional index weight, and they've outperformed the index by 25% year to date. So we think this is really where investors need to be focusing their attention.
So how does this compare to what you're seeing in other places like the U.S.?
We're seeing a very similar phenomenon in the U.S. In fact, you could argue that the U.S. is the driver of this and that Asia in many ways is reflective of those changes that are taking place in the U.S. So the top five stocks in the U.S. now take up a greater proportion of the S&P 500 index than they ever have before, including during the late 1990s, early 2000 tech bubble. The difference, of course, is that now the top five stocks, the so-called FANGs, are driven by profitability and cash flow, whereas 20 plus years ago, they were it was much more of a concept-driven phenomenon. So the same underlying fundamental drivers of in the digital economy, where pricing is transparent and where scale is rewarded, the largest companies tend to become the dominant ones. You get network effects, you get global efficiency and scale in an efficient manner. And this is driving the winners to become bigger and more dominant. So very much the same trends that we've seen in the US are manifesting in Asia as well. And that's indeed why we chose to write this piece.
Two growing concerns for tech investors are the risk of overcrowding and overvaluation. How do you think about those?
Well, it's right to be concerned about them because these stocks have performed very, very well. Valuations have expanded very considerably. And so any rational investor would ask the question of if it's too late to join the proverbial party and what are the risks of jumping on a so-called momentum bandwagon. In the case of the Asian internet sector, we think that although it's still clearly not the same early days that it was 5 years ago when it was only 5% of the overall index, we still think that there's more to go for two key reasons. One, if you look at the history of the different sectors which have been dominant at any particular time, we'd note, for example, that financials had a 35% index weighting in 2015, which is well above the current 22% for the internet sector. In fact, we just saw the crossover between the weighting of financials and the internet sector, with the internet sector just tipping past financials for the first time ever. But given the absolute level of concentration and the superior underlying profit growth, we think that there's more to go in this regard. Now, in terms of valuation, that is something which also one needs to be mindful of. I mean, we're using the term acceptable valuation. We would not argue that the sector is cheap, certainly not relative to where it's traded in the past. But if you look at, for example, a comparison of pricing versus growth, the so-called PEG ratio, price earnings to growth ratio, the internet sector is trading on a 1.2 times PEG, which is just slightly above where other parts of the region are trading. So we don't think that the sector is egregiously valued in aggregate. And we would also note that in comparison to the internet bubble 20 years ago, where companies were being bid up on concepts of scalability and, you know, a number of clicks per page and so forth and eyeballs per page, now the phenomenon is rooted in fundamental profitability. We've done an ROE decomposition of the internet sector, and we can show that its superior margins, good asset turns, and actual net cash, which is driving the superior returns. So we think that the fundamentals are much more grounded now than they were 20 years ago.
So Tim, given that, what's your outlook for Asia's equity markets moving into the rest of the year?
We've had a constructive near-term view on markets. In fact, beginning of the summer, in early June, we took a more pro-cyclical stance and dialed up our emphasis on technology and offset that with an underweight in banks. The key reason there is we've got these strong secular trends for technology, which we've been discussing, amplified by the impact of the virus outbreak, which has accelerated the adoption of the digital consumption of goods and services. So underlying very strong growth trends have gotten kind of a turbocharged by the virus outbreak. In contrast, the banking sector, we think, is still going to be under pressure because in contrast to normal cyclical recoveries where interest rates tend to rise and yield curves steepen, we have exceedingly accommodative monetary policy and rates that are likely to be lower for considerably longer. That means flat yield curves, low interest rates, still continuing concerns about credit costs, and that is not an environment which typically is favorable for banks. So bottom line here is that markets have had a good run. We think there still is some further to go. We do, however, have some concerns as we get deeper into the year around a number of issues, which would include a slowing of the momentum of recovery, both in at the macro level and in earnings, valuations that have expanded and appear to be discounting events quite considerably into the future, perhaps some concerns over the United States presidential election and how that might affect the US equity market and in turn Asian equity markets, as well as the fact that markets have just risen over 43% from their March low and there could be some profit taking. So that suggests to us there might be an air pocket or two in the back end of the year. And in rolling all that together, we think we're in equity market terms, what we might call a fat and flat environment, where we might not see as strong aggregate gains, but the rewards really will come much more at the sort of micro or alpha level. And here is where we think this digital economy theme will continue to play well, and we advise investors to continue to focus on that.
Thanks, Tim.
Thanks very much. Appreciate it.